Yes. All right, like she said, my name is Angel, and our passage comes from 1 Peter 3:15 through 17. So hear these words. But in your hearts, revere Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you, to give the reason for the hope that you have. But do this with gentleness and respect, keeping a clear conscience so that those who speak maliciously against your good behavior in Christ may be ashamed of their slander. For it is better if it is God's will to suffer for doing good than for doing evil. These words are true and can be trusted. Amen.
As Angel said, if we've not met, my name is Craig, and I have the great pleasure of serving as one of the pastors here at University Caroline. And since Pastor Maria earlier was joking, before Taylor fires me, I just thought this was funny, because Andrew's encouragement for me this morning as I was walking out the door was, don't get fired, Dad. So, I mean, on one hand, I mean, it was done in a very encouraging spirit. So he just sets the bar. Hey, as long as you've not gotten fired, like, it's just all gravy at that point, right? So this morning, we're going to dive right into our passage. A theme for us as a church, that we would be a people, that we would be a church that's seeking renewal, God's renewal, that we would be a renewed people, that we would be drawing from the deep wells of living water, that our lives would be marked by change, transformation, that God's grace would work in us, that he would do a work through us, that our lives would look more like Jesus as we follow him together. And I think this passage, these words from the Apostle Peter are a good anchor for us, particularly in our cultural moment. So Angel read for us three verses, and we'll touch on other parts of it, but we're really going to focus on the middle section of one of those verses, and it is this: always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give a reason for the hope that you have. Now, two disclaimers from the top as we get into Peter's words today. One, God in his grace revealed to me this week how much work yet he still has to do in me. This is one of those like preach one to yourself kind of sermons. And secondly, if you're here and you're not totally sure about this whole Christianity thing, if you would not yet say, I am trying to follow Jesus, then this sermon is not for you. You are off the hook. Although, this does give you material, because Peter gives material to the early church and to us of how Christians, how followers of Jesus are supposed to behave. So you can call us on that. I just ask that you do it with grace, because we're all in progress towards that end. So before we dive in, if you would please bow your heads in prayer with me. Almighty Father, it is a good thing to gather together in this, your house, as brothers and sisters in Christ. God, I pray that this time would be a time that we come to understand just a little more deeply. It would be a little more clear who you are and who you have called us to be. And God, that we would be reminded of the responsibility we have for one another, that we are called to help each other follow you more faithfully. Help one another that our lives would look more like your Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. And all God's people said, amen. Well, what struck me in these words of Peter are just the assumptions that he makes as he writes about a hope, that followers of Jesus are to have hope. He didn't spend a whole paragraph outlining what that hope looks like. It's basically implied. Peter is writing to these first followers of Jesus with the assumption that they are people whose lives are full of hope. It is self-evident for Peter that to follow Jesus means that our lives are marked by hope, that there is an expectation of hope that Peter has for, now I can see you all way better. You all were very dark back there. There was an assumption that Peter had that to follow Jesus means that we are called to be people of hope, and that hope is something that leads to transformation in our lives. That hope is something that's apparent to outsiders, to those who aren't following Jesus, and that hope not just is something that leads to transformation, that is apparent to people outside of the faith, but it causes curiosity. It causes someone to ask the question, what do they have that I do not? This is the assumption or expectation. Peter is just writing this as an assumed thing, that to follow Jesus, we are meant to be people that are marked by hope. And as I said, I think particularly in the current cultural moment that we find ourselves, that this is a word for the church of Jesus Christ. This is God calling us back and into account that we are called to be people that are marked out by a hope, something that looks different, something that causes people to ask a question, where does it come from, this hope that you have? Which is our first question. Do you have that hope? That is the invitation that God makes. That is the gift of grace that God extends to each of us, that we would all be people of hope. Is your life, as you follow Jesus, marked by an eternal hope rooted in the person of Christ? Which leads us to our next question. If Peter is assuming that to follow Jesus means that we have hope, that hope does a work in the follower of Jesus, a work of change, a work of transformation, or to use a churchy word, sanctification, like what is the character of that hope? How would we describe that hope? What's the effect of that hope? That hope leads to transformation, and that transformation is something for those who don't already follow Jesus that is compelling. As in, they ought to see what Peter is writing to these first followers in what would be modern-day Turkey, that this letter was meant to be passed around, a circular letter, to encourage all these little churches that are mostly made up of people who didn't grow up Jewish, that have started following Jesus, that are being persecuted by the culture that they find themselves in. What is it to follow Jesus? And Peter says clearly, the assumption is you are to be people of hope, and you're to live in a way that causes the people who aren't already following Jesus to ask you a question of what is different about you. And that is like what is different about you in the positive sense, not in the negative sense. Like, I don't want anything to do with that. It's rather, it's that we're to live in a way. It's Peter's assumption to the church that they're to live in a way that causes people to ask the question, what do you have? What is the source of something that I see in you that I don't have in myself? It's meant to be countercultural. Peter's, as he writes, you can tell he's not just saying, oh, to be a follower of Jesus means you're just like a little extra nice, like of a normal average person you would find in the culture around them. What Peter is writing and assuming of these Christians is that they are living in a way that is so countercultural that it stands in contrast to kind of how everybody else is living. It's meant to be a stark setting apart that to follow Jesus means that we live our lives differently than those who don't follow Jesus. That is one of Peter's assumptions here in this passage. And lastly, that it does cause someone to ask the question, right? What do they have that I don't have? Now, these Christians are a minority in their context. Now, we live in an ever-increasingly post-Christian context. This would be a pre-Christian context where it would not be assumed that an average person would be a follower of Jesus. They are the strange ones. They're being persecuted for their strangeness. They wouldn't have maybe access to the same social capital or institutions that a normal person living in their communities would. It is following Jesus has had a cost for them. And Peter writes even earlier in his letter to this church that it is God's will that by doing good, you should have a response to those that are critiquing you. That there is something implicit in Peter's call to these first followers of Jesus, that one of the first things that people who aren't following Jesus can see of people who are following Jesus is that they're living in a way that is of benefit to their communities, right? That they're living fully. Now, my mother-in-law would regularly use this cultural axiom. Never take advice from someone you wouldn't switch places with. So, for example, if I'm looking for financial advice, I'm not going to someone whose life is in fiscal ruin because they've gambled it all away. If I ask someone for advice and their first words are, you know, there's some really great odds on the Cleveland Browns winning the Super Bowl, that's not going to be someone I'm going to take financial advice from. And as a Cleveland sports fan, I will say that's also probably a terrible bet to make, right? We're not going to take swim lessons from someone who's never been in a pool before. What Peter is saying is that early church, you followers of Jesus, have been entrusted with something that you are meant to share. You are to have hope, hope that is compelling, hope that is transforming. And that's not meant to just stay with you. Someone invited you into the family of faith, and you are meant to share it with others. Unless the world sees followers of Jesus living in a way that causes them to ask the question, how are these followers of Jesus living more peacefully in the midst of all of the cultural angst and anxiety? How are these followers of Jesus living in a way that when I'm just with them, I don't know what it is, but I just feel seen, valued, welcomed? If people who aren't following Jesus look to followers of Jesus and don't see what it's looked like to live a life that is more generous of our time, of our resources, seeking to meet the needs in our community around us, people will not ask the question, where does your hope come from? And I think often in our current cultural moment, we have so much anxiety of losing the cultural position that Christianity once had. We are quick to offer a response and an answer before anyone has asked the question. Friends, are we living in a way where there is a hope of Jesus Christ that is so foundational for who we are, it causes us to live in a way that people who aren't following Jesus would ask, why are they living that way? They're not going to take advice. No one's going to take advice from us as followers of Jesus unless they see that the fruit of following Jesus leads to something that they would want in their own lives. Peter's order of operations here, I think, is crucial. He says, be ready to give an account. We don't even have time to get to what does giving an account look like. That's in a whole other sermon. That would be a great sermon. That's not today's sermon. Peter's order of operations here is that you're living in a way that causes someone to ask you the question, what is different about you? That's all we have time for today. And that is Peter's assumption. And I don't think that that's just an assumption that Peter would make of the early church. I think that that's what is meant to be of followers of Jesus today as well. And I'd submit that those areas of life where we feel most defensive, most angsty, most know-it-all-y are the areas where we have nudged Jesus's redemption to the side, that we have redeemed ourselves. Dietrich Bonhoeffer calls that cheap grace, right? The grace that doesn't come from God, it's the grace that we just give ourselves, that there is something more substantive. But if we want people to take advice, and Peter says this is like the best advice, what is the best way to live? What are the most important things of life? Where do we find our meaning and purpose? If people are going to ask questions of advice of the ultimate things, there has to be a life lived that looks different because of those ultimate things. Friends, people aren't going to ask us the question. And this is a moment of vulnerability. I don't often have someone come and ask, why are you living so differently? I've not had someone ask, you know, what is the source of the hope that is within you? And I think that ought to be convicting for each of us as we follow Jesus, that this is the assumption that Paul makes for these first followers of Jesus. Now, on the defensive, angsty, know-it-all-y, if the world sees the church as just as defensive and angsty and know-it-all-y as what they see everywhere else on social media and in the news, they will not ask us the question, where does your hope come from? Now, on the know-it-all-y part, one of the great gifts of marriage is an increased sense of self-awareness. That sometimes in marriage, there are things that are brought up that you were not aware of. previously that had not yet been brought to your attention. Now, I can speak of this because they are so rare. They stand out so starkly, right? That like the Olympics, once every 4 years, I will have a bout of know-it-all-ism, and Erin will remind me in love and in grace that her least favorite version of me is the know-it-all-y version of me, right? But this, that defensiveness, that angstiness, wherever we feel that in ourselves, that that ought to be a test that we have found our hope in the wrong thing. That we are finding our hope in being approved, that we have the right answer, that we have a witty response, that where we feel that ought to be a good test for us and a good invitation that God extends through his grace, that we would return, that we would find our hope in the only place that can satisfy. It's like we put a plastic crown on ourselves, declare ourselves king, that we have figured it out. If only they would listen to my advice, if only they would see the world exactly how I see the world, then all of their problems would be resolved. And what Peter is reminding these first followers of Jesus, and what Peter's calling us to today, is that the whole thing is that we don't have it all figured out. And when someone asks the question, how are you living different? It's not because I'm just a really holy person or a really pious person. You're like, no, I live this way because of the person of Jesus, because what he did for me, what I couldn't do for myself. And I can't help but live in a way that looks different because of what God has done for me through the person of Jesus. I said it before, but the pastor of the church that I went to in undergrad up in Gainesville would summarize it this way. Are you smoking what you're selling? Unless people see that we actually believe, right, that it has an effect on us, that it is so good that we're like, this is how I want to spend my life, no one is going to respond with an invitation of, this is how you ought to spend your life. Friends, it has to start with a compelling picture of the grace of God working in the follower of Jesus Christ. Another aspect on the character of hope. I think this is an important word for us today, too. Peter writes in verse 17, "For it is better, if it is God's will, to suffer for doing good than for doing evil." Peter is clear. He's reminding this church, this persecuted church, this church that is facing maybe cultural rejection or scorn or shame, that just because you started following Jesus, and just because that's actually led to transformation in your life, that doesn't just mean that all things are going to work out. Peter is reminding these followers of Jesus that the road of the path of faith is not one that is just paved, smooth, and easy. He reminds them and he reminds us that just because we are following Jesus and that our hope is found in the person of Jesus, that it doesn't just resolve all the problems that we do have. And that their hope ought not be found in all of their circumstances working out. Peter's assumption is that there is hope that is independent of persecution or shame or scorn or rejection, that there is roots that can go deeper than that. It's not dictated by our circumstances. Now, for any parents in the room, I'm sure you are familiar with this common child protest when something happens that they don't like. And it is the phrase, it's not fair, right? I think very early in life, we develop this intrinsic fairness filter. And you can't convince me it's actually not developed in utero. We just don't have a way to express it yet. But I digress. We have this intrinsic fairness filter that when we see how the world ought to be and something doesn't line up with it, or how we've seen other people treated and our experience doesn't line up to their experience, we respond with, it's not fair. Now, if you have more than one child, this is maybe a scenario that this plays out, or at least this is how it's played out in the Bloker household. So I brought along a picture of Andrew and Josie. So walked around the corner, they're watching a movie, and this was their natural movie watching position, okay? It is adorable, they are wonderful kids, and Andrew is a wonderful big brother. No one can mess with Josie unless it's him. So lest you think this is emblematic of their relationship at all times, There is this situation which plays itself out not too rarely in our household. We'll hear Andrew and Josie playing together in another room. And Erin's hearing is better than mine. She picks up on this quicker, but even I can pick up on this sometimes. The tone of their voices with each other changes. Maybe the volume increases a little bit. You can hear that things are on a negative trajectory. And we know how this ends up at some point, how it's going to be. Often what happens is Josie is recognizing her relationship with her brother in this moment is not going well. And so she will come and appeal to a higher authority. Now, normally it would be Erin, in a pinch, I'll do. And she'll say something like, Andrew said, and then goes in and fills in the blank of how her older brother has become dominating or controlling of the behavior that she has, and that is not fair to her. He is appealing on an authority that he does not have. And she has taken offense to this, and so she is appealing to a higher authority. Friends, we get stuck in current cultural muck and the news of the day that it's like Andrew and Josie arguing with one another. What God is inviting us to is to come and to appeal to a higher authority. Some of my role as a father in those moments is to set reality for Josie. This is how things actually are. She feels it's unfair that her older brother, right, as siblings can be prone to do. I'm an older brother. I never did this with my little brother, but some older brothers might do. That there is something that is off there. So she's appealing to a higher authority. She recognizes that as it's going isn't working. They can keep picking at each other. They can keep nipping at each other. But knowing that that's not going to go anywhere, so there's an appeal to a higher authority. Friends, God is inviting us, as we follow Jesus, not just to get stuck in our current cultural muck, but rather to appeal to our Father. If we first appeal to Facebook or Instagram or TikTok before we appeal to our Father in heaven, it's a marker that something is off in our prayer life. God invites us to him that we would be reminded of the grace and love of truth, that he has created us and that he has good things for his children, as Maria said earlier. We need to make sure that our fairness filter is tuned to the right standard. If we just look at the world around us and settle for what is fair according to the things of the world, we will be just as defensive, angsty, and know-it-all-y as anything anyone else would see. God's invitation that as we follow Jesus, our fairness filter would be reoriented not on what we have done or what is right or fair or just, but it would be reoriented on the saving work of Jesus. That God got off of his throne and came and lived and died and rose from the dead, that we would have new life, not because we deserved it, but because of the love that God has for us, his creation. We need to be reminded regularly that it is God ultimately who is judge, that one day God will come and God will make right everything that has been made wrong. That is God's role. That's a task he has not fully delegated to us as followers of Jesus. Now, I think in the United States, we have some level of understanding that if a wrong has been done to us, we have an authority that we can appeal to. Sometimes that ends up in a court trial, right? And if we appeal to a jury of our peers, we can represent, and that what was wrong will be made right. Now, the other thing we know about our court system is it's not exactly the fastest process in the world. The invitation that God has for us is that we would find our hope is rooted in faith that God ultimately will one day return and make all things right. And we trust that he will do that, that God is good. God desires good things for his children, that he looks out for us, and that all that is wrong will be made right. We have a court date. Now, that date may be after Jesus returns or he calls us home, but that our faith is, in the meantime, before our case is called, we have hope that there will be justice. We don't need to take it all into our hands. We seek justice for others, but we are content in recognizing God is the perfect and ultimate judge. That faith that that is, that God is who he says he is, gives us a hope that can overcome the circumstances that we find ourselves in, that allow us to live in a way that is different. Which leads us to the foundation of the hope, that there's an expectation that God's followers of Jesus would have hope, that hope is something that causes people to ask the question, what is different? But that foundation of that hope, Peter reminds the church in this letter and reminds us that our hope is found only in the person of Jesus. Our hope is in the character of God in the person of Jesus Christ. Because Peter reminds this persecuted, rejected, marginalized church that it was not fair that Jesus was mocked and scorned as he was arrested. It was not fair that Jesus was rejected. It was not fair that Jesus' teaching were left to the side from even his closest friends and followers. And yet God's love for us is so deep that there is an invitation to restored relationship. There's an invitation and offer of grace. The old phrase in the communion liturgy would have everyone repeat, Christ has died, Christ has risen, and Christ will come again. That is the foundation for our hope. Our hope is not found in what we see in the world around us, but merely that Christ has died, Christ has risen, and that Christ will come again. Now, Paul is actually writing from the same foundation. He's actually writing to another church in Asia Minor, or modern-day Turkey, in the book of Colossians, his letter to the church there. He writes something that sounds very similar to what Peter is writing. So these Christians, they might have received a letter from Peter and then a letter from Paul. Paul's words in Colossians 4, 5, and 6 say this, be wise, or like the literal Greek translation, walk in wisdom, in the way you act towards outsiders, making the most of every opportunity. Let your conversation be always full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone. Paul's assumption is that outsiders can be insiders. Paul seems less concerned here of if he is right, of if he has gotten his point across, and more concerned that those people who are not yet following Jesus have the opportunity to follow Jesus. And that cannot be done without wisdom, without conversation that is always full of grace, seasoned with salt. Paul's assumption is that everyone is called to it. It's not just like a church staff thing, that everyone who follows Jesus is meant to be able to speak to and to share wisely in the way that they act towards outsiders. The enemy would love nothing more than the church of Jesus Christ to not share the person of Jesus with the world. The filter that Paul gives, if we're to read these words of Paul and to take them as true, does my life or does my posture in a given circumstance or situation reasonably help someone who isn't following Jesus to have a clearer picture of who God is? I might have drawn it up differently. You might have drawn it up differently. The way that God has chosen to reveal himself to the world are through those who would follow Jesus, that their lives point people to a clearer picture, an ever-clarifying picture of who Jesus is. That is what it is to follow Jesus. Now, Paul also recognizes, as he writes to the Romans, right, all have fallen short of the glory of God. We have this great call. Each of us have fallen short, are in need of God's grace. But what the world needs more than anything are followers of Jesus whose lives are so rooted on the hope of God's character and the person of Jesus Christ that there is a clear, ever-clarifying picture of who Jesus is and the love that God has for them. Friends, people won't respond to Jesus, our family, our friends, our neighbors, unless they see us living in a way that causes them to ask the question, what is different? What do they have? What is the source of the hope that you live out of? John Calvin, so all my Presbyterian Reformed brothers and sisters would be proud that I can also go from the Reformed well. John Calvin has said this, we should ask God to increase our hope when it is small, awaken it when it is dormant, conform it when it is wavering, strengthen it when it is weak, and raise it up when it is overthrown. The invitation as we move towards responding in communion, and the band can make their way back up front, is that we are invited